Even now, Lord Jesus, even now, even now, for I ask this in your name. Amen. God be praised. Amen. What a wonderful privilege God has granted us to come to worship him in spirit and in truth. He inhabits the praises of his people, and we who are his people must not be inhibited by what he inhabits. He has brought us here to worship him. This is just a dress rehearsal. It is a Kodak moment for the future state of eternity. In other words, we're just getting into redemptive rhythm. What we're doing here is just a dress rehearsal, and it is a foretaste of glory divine. I love it. It's hard to contain what God does when heaven comes down and glory fills our souls. And this is just a dress rehearsal. This is just a sample of what heaven is going to be about. It is being in the presence of our King and worshiping him for eternity. I want to thank Dr. Craig Connor for this privilege of coming to stand in this pulpit where the gospel is being preached in its fullness every Sunday. Amen. And I don't have to come down. In fact, I wouldn't do that anyway. But it's wonderful to be able to be in a place where you know that people are suckled in scripture and where people don't want sermonic happy meals for sermons. They don't want snacks. They don't want gimmicks. They don't want novelties. They want the truth, nothing but the truth, the whole truth. They want the gospel of God. And so I'm grateful that I stand in a place where your pastor has been standing now for some 15 years, preaching the unsearchable riches of Jesus Christ. I want to thank God for him. I want to thank God for his longevity. I want to thank God for this church that has decided to stay here in these parts and minister the gospel not only in these parts but throughout the world. We're appreciative for your global mission, that is, your global and local brought together, making it a global mission. To Sister Karen Connor, we praise God for her. I don't have to tell you. She is not shy about Jesus. Amen. And she is who she is. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to meet people who are authentic and who are not just trying to wear the office or the title. She is who she is. And I thank God for her vibrant spirits and for her love for Jesus. She came into the office on cloud nine, had never seen the sister before. I'm here. She's mentioned. Come out of Sunday school on her way to the choir. We praise God for her. And for the greatest woman, I think, that God has on planet Earth, Dr. Wanda Taylor Smith, my beautiful wife. Now, you need to see her, so I'm going to, y'all put the screen on her as she stand up. Everybody, come on. Stand up, baby. Stand up. Everybody look at her. That's her. That's my wife. She has a wonderful ministry to young people and a wonderful ministry to women, ministers' wives, abused women, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And much of her ministry is carried on in the shadows, but God brings it to the light so that she can be the light of the world and do good works that people may see the wonderful works in her and as a reflection glorify the Father which is in heaven. So it's a blessing to be here. Sister Dee Dee is here, I trust, if she's not in the kitchen. Is Sister Dee Dee here? Where are you, Sister Dee Dee? She's not here. She's in the kitchen. Sister Dee Dee, when we came to the hotel, two beautiful, coordinated, custom-designed baskets, thoughtfully selected products were there. And I want to thank her and the staff for providing us with such niceties, and the spirit of hospitality is in this place, and what a privilege it is to be here. My friends, Bill and Myrna Sears, who have hosted us It's just been wonderful. So we praise God for these things. The 48th chapter of Genesis. The 48th chapter of Genesis. I want to ask you this question. How do you spell father? How do you spell father? Genesis chapter 48, verses 1 through 20. Hear these words from the Word. After this, Joseph was told, "Your father is ill." So he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. When Jacob was told, "Your son Joseph has come to you," he summoned strength and sat up in his bed. And Jacob said to Joseph, "God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan, and he blessed me and said to me, 'I am going to make you fruitful and increase your numbers. I will make of you a company of peoples and will give this land to your offspring after you for perpetual holding.' Therefore, your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt are now mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine, just as Reuben and Simeon are. As for the offspring born to you after them, they shall be yours. They shall be recorded under the names of their brothers with regard to their inheritance. For when I came from Padan, Rachel, alas, died in the land of Canaan on the way, while there was still some distance to go to Ephrath, and I buried her there on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. When Israel saw Joseph's sons, he said, 'Who are these?' Joseph said to his father, 'These are my sons, whom God has given me here.' And he said, 'Bring them to me, please, that I may bless them.' Now the eyes of Israel were dim with age, and he could not see well. So Joseph brought them near him, and he kissed them and embraced them. Israel said to Joseph, 'I did not expect to see your face, and here God has let me see your children also.' Then Joseph removed them from his father's knees, and he bowed himself with his face to the earth. Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left, and Manasseh in his left hand toward Israel's right, and brought them near him. But Israel stretched out his right hand and laid it on the head of Ephraim, who was the younger, and his left hand on the head of Manasseh, crossing his hands, for Manasseh was the firstborn. He blessed Joseph and said, 'The God before whom my ancestors Abraham and Isaac walked, the God who has been my shepherd all my life to this day, the angel who has redeemed me from all harm, bless these boys. And in them let my name be perpetuated and the name of my ancestors Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow into a multitude on the earth.' When Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. So he took his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. Joseph said to his father, 'Not so, my father. Since this one is the firstborn, put your right hand on his head.' But his father refused and said, I know, my son, I know. He also shall become a people. He also shall be great. Nevertheless, his younger brother shall be greater than he, and his offspring shall become a multitude of nations.' So he blessed them that day, saying, 'By you, Israel, will evoke blessings, saying, God make you like Ephraim and like Manasseh.' So he put Ephraim ahead of Manasseh." The book of Hebrews in chapter 11 furnishes for us the caption that we're very familiar with. The heroes of faith, the heroines of faith, the heroes and heroines of the faithful. Each one of them is characterized by some act or some notable action of faith. Their lives are filled with action, with intrigue, with resolve. In fact, some of the characters, their lives have furnished for the motion picture industry titles that we well remember. Moses and the Ten Commandments, Charlton Heston. And we hear in chapter 11, verses 24 to 26, the faithful act of Moses. And Moses, when he was come of years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, but choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. Or who can forget David, verse 32 of Hebrews chapter 11. David and Bathsheba, that saga, a motion picture production. Or in verse 32, Samson and Delilah. And who can forget that saga, a motion picture production. Their lives were full of action and intrigue and resolve. And yet in verse 21, there seems to be a unique rendering of an action that lacks intrigue, that lacks action, and that lacks resolve. Look at it in verse 21 of Hebrews chapter 11. And Jacob, when he was dying, blessed the sons of Joseph, worshiped God leaning on a staff. Where is the action? Where is the intrigue? Where is the resolve? It needs to have some more seasoning on it, seemingly. A little more salt, a little more pepper, some hot sauce, perhaps some ketchup. Not like Daniel in the lion's den. Not like Shadrach, Meshach, and a bad Negro in the fiery furnace. Not like Samson taking the jawbone of an ass and killing 3,000 Philistines. All Israel, the covenant name of Jacob, did was to bless the sons of Joseph, worship God, lean on a staff as he was dying. Seems to lack action, seems to lack intrigue, seems to lack resolve. The background of this is in Genesis chapter 47, verses 29 through 31. When Jacob is dying, he sends for his son, his favorite son, Joseph, the one that he had a coat of many colors custom designed for him. He sends for him, and Joseph arrives, and he says to Joseph, I know I'm dying, but I don't want my body to be left in Egypt. I want you to promise, I want you to swear that when I die, that my body will be transported from Egypt to the sacred burial grounds of my ancestors. And of course, Jacob promises he will ensure that that is done. Joseph does, rather. Chapter 48, verses 1 and following. Instead of Jacob sending for Joseph, Joseph hears that his father Jacob is dying. And Joseph makes his way to his father's house. He does not go alone. He takes his two sons, the eldest one, Manasseh, the younger one, Ephraim. He takes them with him. He arrives. His father, Jacob, is informed that his son Joseph has come. And the Bible says in verse 2 that when Jacob hears that, he summons strength. He garners strength. He gathers up his strength and sits up in the bed to receive his favorite son, because he's getting ready to utter his last words. Because last words become lasting in their import. Last words become lasting in their import. I will never forget that day, February 1996. My father was ill. He had gone from 230 pounds to about 125, skin and bones. And when he heard that I had come into the house, he gathered up his strength and sat up in the bed to give me his last words. And here were his last words. Little Robert, since he was Robert Sr., I believe the Lord is getting ready to call me home. I want you to take care of your mama. That's all he said. He didn't need to tell me that, but because he said that, last words have lasting import. And so Jacob said to Joseph, I have some last words to give you. Listen to his words. He says, God has blessed me, and God has made me fruitful, and God has given me land, and God has multiplied me and my family. And so he says in verse number 5 of Genesis 48, the sons that were born of you and your wife, namely your eldest son Manasseh and your youngest son Ephraim, those two boys are now mine. Just as Reuben and Simeon are yours, mine, these two boys are also mine. He says, your mother, Joseph, Rachel, died on her way to Ephrath, which is Bethlehem. He still has that sad memory. And then in verse number 8, he asks, as he looks out through those eyes that were now almost closed, he says, who are these who are with you? Because the Bible says in verse number 10 that his eyes were dim. And Joseph responds in verse 9 by saying, these are my boys, Manasseh and Ephraim, your grandsons. And hear the words of Jacob in verse number 11. I never thought that I would ever see you again. But God has blessed me that I not only see you, I see my grandsons. What a delight to be able to watch children grow up, to get married, and then to go to school, and then to be blessed to have children which become your grandchildren. And you know they're your grandchildren because when you see your kids, the first thing you do is ask how the grandkids, not how are you doing. He's blessed. And he looks through those eyes that are almost closed, and his son Joseph says, these are your grandchildren. He wants to make sure that he blesses the right one in proportion. He can remember when he got the testamentary blessing because his father Isaac, whose eyes were almost shut, trusted his tactile senses by touching the goat skin that Mother Rebecca had put on Jacob, and trusting his sensorial faculties, and blessed Jacob instead of blessing Esau. Even though God was behind all of that, he wants to make sure that he blesses the right one. And so he says, bring them to me. And Joseph begins to position Ephraim and Manasseh. He puts Manasseh on the right side, who is the oldest one, so that Jacob can put his hands. And notice the covenant name is mentioned here in verse 10. It's no longer Jacob, it's Israel. The name that he got after wrestling with the angel in chapter 32 of Genesis. He puts his right hand on Manasseh, and he puts his father's left hand on the younger Ephraim, because the older will get the greatest amount of the estate and will be the head of that family. But the Bible says in verse number 12 that Jacob bowed his head prostrate to the ground. So he's not seeing what's taking place. What Israel, who is Jacob, that's his covenant name Israel, does is to cross his hands, so that his right hand is now on the younger man's head, Ephraim, and his left hand is on the older son's head, Manasseh.
And Joseph is not aware of it because in verse 12, his head is bowed to the ground and he is facing the ground and not seeing what is taking place. What Joseph did was to go according to orientation, cultural orientation, protocol, tradition. And he brings these boys without ever, at least we don't see it in scripture, praying over it, brings his presuppositions, brings his self-interest, brings the protocol, brings the traditional way of doing things to his father and expects his father, Israel, to bless that because Israel represents God. How often do we do that, brothers and sisters? We take and bring unprayed for plans. We bring unprayed for actions and desires and wishes to God and said to God, God, bless it. We don't ask God oftentimes, how do you want to do this? We don't say to him, and my will be lost in thine. We don't say to him, not my will, but thine be done. We bring our Manasses and we bring our Ephraims in that kind of order and expect God to bless them. But God is sovereign, which means that God can do anything he wants to do, when he wants to do it, how he wants to do it, and he doesn't owe us an explanation. Listen to the blessing. Israel says, bring these boys close to me so that I can bless them. He crosses his hands and he says, the God who appeared to me at Luz, the one whom my ancestors, Abraham, my granddaddy, and Isaac, my father, walked before this God. The God who's been my shepherd and a shepherd to me all the days of my life. The God who has redeemed me from evil. Bless these boys. May the name of my ancestors be perpetuated throughout their lives. May my name be perpetuated throughout their lives. And may God give them a multitudinous nation. And then the Bible says in verse 17, when Joseph looked up, that is, when Joseph saw that his father Israel's hands, his covenant name, had been crossed so that his right hand is on the younger man's head, Ephraim, and his left hand is on the older son's head, Manasseh, he tries to pull them apart. And the Bible says that Israel refused. He said, no, my father. Manasseh is the oldest. Ephraim is the youngest. No. The truth of the matter is he thought that his father was having a senior moment. He thought that his father was experiencing some kind of Alzheimer's. And I'm sensitive when I use that word. He thought that his father was having the beginning stage of dementia. He thought that his father was experiencing senioritis. No, my father, Manasseh is the oldest. Ephraim is the youngest. And you've crossed your hand and you have undone what culture said ought to be done. God does not have senior moments. God does not have dementia. God doesn't experience senioritis. He knows exactly what needs to be done. Amen. He tries to pull his hands apart, but the old man may have lost a vision in his eyes, but his hands are strong. The young man can't undo what Israel has done. And then Israel says to him, I know, my son, I know what I am doing. Brothers and sisters, sometimes God does this in our lives. He crosses his hands. And when we try to undo it and he does it, we get upset because we don't like the prayers that he vetoes. We don't like the way he rearranges some of our relationships. It's kind of like Job. In the first two chapters of the book of Job, God is talking about Job behind Job's back, and Job doesn't even know anything about it. God is talking to the devil behind Job's back. And the devil has said to God, after God says, have you considered my servant Job? And the devil says, yes, but you have him under divine protective custody, and I cannot get to him. And I can't get to him unless you give me permission. And God says, I tell you what, I'll take down the hedge and let you get to him. And you can do anything you want to do to him, but you cannot take his life. Chapter 1, God talks about Job. Chapter 2, God talks about Job. Job has no idea that God is talking about him and that God has picked him out, that he might be picked on. And he has no idea that he's going to be in the book of the Bible. And he has no idea that the book of the Bible is going to be named after him, the book of Job. Chapter 1, chapter 2. For 35 straight chapters, God says absolutely nothing. Check it out. Chapter 3 all the way to chapter 37. God says nothing. And then in chapter 38, God reenters the dialogue by asking Job questions from 38, 39, 40, 41. Where were you, Job, chapter 38, when I laid the foundation of the world? He flunked the first question and every one of them. So much so that when chapter 42 comes, God asked Job, now you said you wanted to say something. And Job says, yes, I heard of you with my ear, but now I've seen you face to face. And I have to admit that everything I've been talking about all these chapters, I had no idea what I was talking about. And I repent in sackcloth and ashes. Because God will give us the first opportunity to question anything that he does. He gives us that first opportunity. But he has the last word, and he speaks and puts Job back into order. Here was the question that I always ask myself and others. Job waited on God to speak for 35 straight chapters. How long can you wait? Some of you right now are in chapter 17. You've got 20 more chapters to wait. 38 is coming. Some of you are in chapter 27. You've got 10 more chapters to wait. And some of you are in chapter 37, halfway through. And you don't know that chapter 38 is going to come. And you're ready to throw in the towel. You're ready to give up. But if you can just hold out to tomorrow, if you can just keep faith through the night, if you can just hold out to tomorrow, everything will be all right, because weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. There will be a breakthrough. There will be deliverance. God has not abandoned you. God has not forgotten about you. God knows your address. God knows your email number. God knows your telephone number. And even if you have to come walking on the water, doing the fourth watch of the night, which is between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m., God will come. I don't know how he's going to come, but he's promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. How long can you wait? And you and I are trying to do this. Søren Kierkegaard, the 19th century Danish theologian, has said, and memorably said, life must be lived forward, but you can only understand it backwards. Life must be lived forward, but you can only understand it backwards, which means when life is coming at you, oftentimes you don't interpret it. You only understand what's taking place reflectively, backwards. And sometimes it takes years before you understand what God is doing. That's really what Joseph will say to his brothers who have betrayed him. The Lord sent me into Egypt. And some of us, maybe sitting here right now, there's a particular individual that you thought that you wanted to get married to. You wanted to date. You wanted to court. And God shut that door, and you're trying to do it. And a few years later, when you see that individual, you want to have a shouting spell. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for shutting that door. There are some positions, some jobs, some colleges, some decisions that you wanted to make and God wouldn't let you. But I tell you what, God does have a permissive will, and if you keep on doing that, he just might let you have it. And you'll get what you want, but you won't want what you get, and it's hard to unget what you got. So you just well as let him have his way, because as Israel said, to Joseph, I know, my son, I know. I know what I'm doing. I know that protocol, and I know that tradition says that the oldest son should have my right hand on him so that he inherits the largest part of the estate. And I've done this so that the youngest son is going to have that. But I know, my son, I know. Have you forgotten that it was not Ishmael through which the promise was, who got the blessing of the promise going through him? It was Isaac. And you ought to know that I was younger than Esau. Esau came out of his mother just before Jacob, but it wasn't through Esau that the promise went. It was through Jacob. And I know that you know that Reuben, your oldest brother, that the blessing was expected to go through him, but it didn't go through him. It went through not the youngest, but the younger brother, Judah. I know what I'm doing. Don't try to undo what I'm doing. I'm working out my plan. When he says, I know, my son, I know, in the Hebrew, it's emphatic. That really means I know. It's like God saying to Abraham in Genesis 22 and 1, Abraham, Abraham. And when he gets ready to kill his son, the angel of the Lord cries out, Abraham, Abraham, stop. Now I know that you fear me more than anything else because you would not withhold your son, your only son. Moses, Moses, take off the shoes from your feet. The ground you're standing on is holy ground. And Samuel, when he hears the voice, says, speak, Lord, your servant is here, is speaking and listening. And you hear that message to Samuel. Samuel, Samuel. Paul on the Damascus Road. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Jesus says to Martha, 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 you are cumbered, you are worried about many things. And Peter, Jesus does not use the name Peter in Luke 22, verse 31 and following. He uses the name Simon, fluttering bird. Simon, Simon, Satan hath desired to sift you as wheat. And Jesus says, verily, verily. And here you hear these words from Israel. I know, my son, I know, I know. It reflects that God works his providential plan according to his own omniscience, that is, his own knowledge. He knows everything before there's anything to know, according to Isaiah chapter 46, verse number 10. It says this to us, that for many New Testament doctrines, there are Old Testament pictures. For many New Testament doctrines, they're Old Testament pictures. And the picture in Isaiah 48, or rather in Genesis 48, is the picture of a New Testament doctrine called adoption. Adoption. For in verse 5 of Genesis 48, Jacob, the name not of his covenant, Jacob says, just as Reuben and Simeon are mine, so are these sons of yours, Ephraim and Manasseh. They are mine. You will not get a tribe, but they will. They will inherit what I have. They are as much mine as my own biological sons, Reuben and Simeon. It's a full-blown picture of adoption. You and I, as children of God, have been adopted. That's why Jesus could say to us in John chapter 1, verse 12, as many as received him, to them gave he the authority. To them gave he the right to be called sons, because sons inherit. Sons of God. So when I'm talking about sons, I'm not dealing with gender. My sister there is a son of God in terms of inheritance. Nothing to do with the fact that she's female. She is a son of God. She is a child of God. How did that happen? Because Jesus is the one of a kind, monogenes, one of the kind son. Hear these words in John chapter 1, verse 17. No one knows the Father, no one knows God except the one and only God, the Son. who is in the bosom of the Father, some interpret it in the heart of the Father, he has exegeted him. That's the word. He has made him known. Because he's the one of a kind son. And because he's the one of a kind son, and there's no other son like him, because he's begotten. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, begotten. Now, in Hebrew, of course, you can have the poetic words of make, the poetic word of create, and the poetic word of begotten. But when you talk about create, you can talk about artistry. When you talk about making, you can talk about producing. But no one, you can't beget arts. You can't beget this pulpit. You got to make it. But when it comes to begetting, someone has to come out of the very being of someone. And God says that the only begotten son that I have is my son, Jesus Christ. He is the express image of the invisible gods. And that gives us the right to be called children of God. Not only that, but the gospel that we preach. Paul says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God to salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And because of that, that means the Jew and the Gentile have revealed what was a mystery to the Jews in the Christian church, and that is that the church is composed of both Jew and Gentile. And the fact that when he says that whoever would believe in him, it's a blank space and you can write your name in it. Whoever. If you're black, you can write your name there. If you're white, if you're Asian, if you're Hispanic, if you're Native American, you can write your name in that. If you're rich, whosoever. If you're poor, whosoever. If you're learned, whosoever. If you're unlearned, whosoever. If you're tall, if you're short, whosoever. If you're a Democrat, if you're Republican, if you're independent, whosoever would believe in him. I don't care what side of the track you're born on. If you're born on this side of the track or the other side of the track, it doesn't matter because God is on both sides of the track. Whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We have been adopted into the family of God, so much so that when we stand on the heavenly shore and wring the blue waters of tribulation from the hem of our garments, then we will see the rainbow people of God, the multicolored wisdom of God in terms of his inclusivity. For Revelation 7:9 says, on that day there will be those coming from every tribe and nation and kindred and tongue. And we're all there because we've been adopted by the Father. Now, how do you spell Father? F-A-T-H-E-R, not sufficient. Capital F-A-T-E-R. It's because of our Father having the F capitalized that my Asian sister is in relationship with her black brother, because we've got the same Father, capital F. Nate Saint was a friend of Jim Elliott's in the mid-1950s. He and Jim Elliott and others were killed by the Aka Indians that they were witnessing to. We know Jim Elliott, we know that great quote, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep in order to gain what he cannot lose. They were killed there. In Amsterdam 2000, some 45 years later approximately, gathered were over 200 nations, people from every tribe, nation, kindred, and tongue. And Cliff Barrows of the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association was leading the singing, and he asked that everyone would sing, I think it was the rendition, Amazing Grace, that song in their own language. It was the most unified cacophony that you'd ever hear. Everybody singing Amazing Grace, same tune, in their different languages. You know why they could do that? Because they spell Father with a capital F. F capital, A-T-H-E-R, because the Father who made them Asian and made them black and made them white and made them Hispanic and made them Native American, America, saved them so that he understands their own language, and it is unity to God in the midst of diversity, so that we don't have to make anybody like us. God has never made cookie cutter Christians. He just made Christians because they represent, if you will, a sample of what heaven is going to be like. Standing on that stage was the son of Nate Saints. His father had been killed by the Aka Indians some 45 years ago. But also standing next to him was the man who killed Nate Saints' father. And Nate Saints' son had the man who killed his father stand next to him because he wanted these over 200 nations to understand that this man who was dressed in his tribal outfit with a spear and a loincloth was now in his family, biologically in his family. The killer of his father was now the godfather of Nate Saints' children, Nate Saints' father's children. In other words, here is a man standing here who is the son of Nate Saints who was killed, and his children are now the grandchildren of the man who killed them. Because now they spell father with a capital F. The murderer of his father is the grand godfather of his own children. Don't you tell me that forgiveness is difficult. Forgiveness is not difficult. It's just impossible without the grace of God. And there's nothing that God cannot enable you and I to forgive people of. I know there's the ache of memory. I know there's the sting of memory. But God can enable us to restore people who have hurt us back to a place where even the sting is not as powerful, and we have released them from any kind of consequence on our part. James English wrote a book. The book is entitled The Handyman of the Lord, which is an account of the work of Dr. William Holmes Borders, who pastored the Wheat Street Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Borders is up preaching, and he gives a story talking about reconciliation. He gives a story, a true story, of a black man who went to a southern mansion and knocked on the door because this man is hungry and he's begging for food. And he knew that the man who lived in this mansion was not only rich, but also a Christian. Knocked on the door, the man came to the door. He said to the man, "Sir, I'm hungry." The man told him, "All right, I'll give you food. Go to the back." And the black man went to the back to give him some food, to receive food. And the white brother said, "Now before we go on to eat, we're going to bless the food. Repeat after me. Our Father." And the Negro, as is put in this book, said, "Your Father." He said, "Our Father." And the Negro said, "Your Father." He said, "Why do you insist on saying your Father when the Lord's Prayer says our Father?" He looked up at him and said, "Well, boss, if I said our Father, wouldn't that make us brothers? And if we are brothers, I don't think the Lord would want me coming to the back to get food from one of his children. Because you spell father with a capital F. He has adopted us." My wife is a lover of cats. Amen. We had a cat named Tim, a male cat. She had him for 21 years, and Tim went to cat heaven. He went to the canine community of the beloved, and it broke her heart. She mourned. This is serious. He was like a member of the family. She mourned. Her best friend told her that she had seen a cat somewhat similar to Tim. He was black. She went and picked the cat up over at her old church, First Baptist Oakley, in that area. Brought the cat home. And that cat enjoyed room temperatures. The cat was brought in from the outside where he had to fend for himself, get his own food, run from dogs and other cats, live out in the cold, all that. Now he's in a climate temperature controlled house. That cat, when it gets hungry and if there's no food in its little pail, will come up and meow, meow, right at my wife's feet, wherever she is, as if to say, it's time for me to eat. That cat, after getting full, will go and lay down somewhere. And whenever she lets the cat out for just a few seconds, just for a moment, the cat wants to come back in, because now the cat knows the comfort of the house and doesn't want to go back to being chased by dogs and cats and trying to make sure it gets his own food. In other words, what we did was to adopt that cat. The cat's name is Sheba. God adopts us. We were on the outside. How does Paul put it in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 and 12 and following? He says, we were dead in trespasses and sin. That means that everybody was born dead spiritually. Dead in trespasses, dead in sin. You say, well, you shouldn't call me dead. I'm a Mercedes-driving person. You're just a Mercedes-driving dead person. Well, I'm a millionaire. You're just a dead possession of millions. Everybody is dead in sin if you're not adopted through Christ. Dead, separated from God. Just like Sheba, separated from that house. And you are separated, and I was separated from God. It's terrible to be separated and to be dead. And we were the walking dead. Paul goes on to say, we were strangers from the commonwealth of Israel and foreigners to the covenant of promise. Here it is. Without God and without hope in this world. But those of you who were afar off are now made to draw nigh by the blood of Christ. Some of the sweetest words. You're talking about a blessed conjunction, but. And if you're sitting here today and you haven't been adopted and you're still on the outside like Sheba trying to make it on your own and you've not been brought into the family of Christ, you are dead in sin, you're dead in trespasses, and you are without God and without hope in the world. And I don't care what you have, when you're without God and without hope, you have nothing. But with God, you have hope and you have everything that you need. We have been adopted. Now, children did not have the greatest esteem among the Romans. In the first century AD, during Paul's time, during Jesus' time, children oftentimes were unwanted, and they would be thrown into the trash heap on the side of the house, and persons who might want a child could come by if the child was alive. They would take that child and raise that child and nurture that child. Some of them would do that, raise the child and nurture the child, only to become a gladiator or a prostitute. They were in the trash heap. You know where God found us? And I know this is going to puncture our pride. God found us in trash. Oh, no, don't say that, Rod. I don't care. That's where we were. Jesus, Luke chapter 19, verse 10, he came to seek and save that which was lost. Some of you have been found in some terrible situations. Some of you are sitting here right now. You have been abused and accused. Some of you are sitting here right now. You have been baffled and you've been beleaguered and you've been befuddled. Some of you sitting here right now, you've been criticized and you've been ostracized and you've been maligned. Some of you sitting here right now, you've been distracted and you have been defeated. Some of you are sitting here right now. You were voted in high school to most likely not to succeed. Your marriages were not supposed to be anything. In fact, you got such a bad diagnosis that the doctor said you only had 3 months. And now you've outlived the doctor who gave you that diagnosis. Some of you are sitting here right now who are giving up on marriages were given up on. But I want to tell you, wherever God has put a comma, don't put a period. And don't let anybody put a period, because God has said, it's just a comma. It's just a pause. I am not finished with you yet. A potter saw a vessel that had been broken by the winds and the rain, and he sought with great compassion to put it back together again. But I was that broken vessel that no one thought was any good. I cried, Lord, you are the potter. I am the clay. Make me over again today. And that's when Jesus picked up the pieces of my broken heart that day and made me a brand new vessel and revived my soul again. I wonder if I'm talking to anybody aside from Robert Smith, that God has found in the ditch, found when you were hopeless, found when nobody had any high estimate for you, found when parents gave up on you, found when life gave up on you, but God found you there, picked you up, saved your life, saved your family, saved your future, saved your whole. And there is no one that's beyond redemption. He finds you where you are. Some Romans wanted to confer honors and privileges on persons, and so emperors like Julius Caesar would adopt folk like Octavian, and Octavian would adopt Tiberius, and Tiberius would adopt Caligula, and Caligula would adopt Nero, all who would become emperors of Rome. That's a great honor, to have those kinds of privileges conferred on you. But when you and I get adopted by the Most High, he adopts us through justification, which means, in essence, we no longer have to suffer the possibility of the penalty of sin, which is death, eternal separation from God. What an honor. When he adopts us and gives us sanctification. Now we have power over sin so that we're free from the power of sin. I'm not talking about perfection. I'm not talking about sinlessness. I think that as we are sanctified and we are being conformed more and more to the image of God's dear Son and start looking more and more like Jesus, that we are not sinless, but we ought to sin less. And God gives us power so that our want-tos become his want-tos, and our don't-want-tos, if you let me put it that way, become his don't-want-tos. And then he gives us, ultimately, the privilege of glorification, where we'll be free from the presence of sin. No more sin, no more sorrow, no more pain. When we stand before him, and in Revelation 22 and 4, we shall see his face, because we have been adopted. Now I know, my sister, I don't know if you're from China or not, but I do know about China. Two of my dearest friends adopted two girls from China. And I do know that over there, the children oftentimes are put in orphanages. And there is an ads section in a paper with the pictures of all of these children, just in case someone stole someone's child, kidnapped someone's child, the parents can come to that orphanage and claim that child. The truth of the matter is, some children are not claimed, and they see their friends being claimed by others and taken to their families, but they are not claimed. Some of you feel right now that nobody wants you. I want you to know God does. And he has come in the person of his Son to claim you. How long has it been since you've talked with the Lord and told him your heart's hidden secret? How long since you prayed? How long since you've stayed on your knees till the light shone through? How long has it been since your mind has been at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? Someone who cares, someone who shares all your troubles like no other can do. He'll come down from the sky, brush the tears from your eyes. You're his child, and he cares for you. He knows, and he has come to your orphanage, and you must be willing to go with him. Well, as I move toward the close, my friends, Teresa and Tile Prince, adopted two children, Bethany and Johanna. He told me that you have to go through a process when you adopt children, particularly from China. Number one, you have to qualify for adoption. You have to fill out all these papers so that one of the checks is for you an economic test. Are you able to check, protect, and raise and care for that child during the balance of the time that child is in your home? Second of all, an ethical test. You got to go to your local district station. Make sure you don't have a record. You're not a criminal. You're not a pedophile. Can't adopt. Third thing, you got to be legit. Whoever you said you are, you have to be. According to your visa, according to your birth certificate, all has to line up. You got to be who you said you are. And then you got to be able, if you will, to pay the price. You got to be able to afford it, because adoption cost them well over $30,000+. You got to be able to pay for it and be able to, in a sustained way, take care of the children. Well, I want to tell you something. The one who adopts you is one who is economically qualified. He's one who is able to afford it. The cattle on 1,000 hills belong to him. I'm not just talking about the hills. I'm talking about the cattle on, it could be 1,000 cattle on one hill. He's able to afford it. My God shall supply all your needs according to your riches. I know that we're going through recession. I understand that, but heaven doesn't know the word recession. Heaven has never been bankrupt. Heaven doesn't have any financial reversals. Heaven is in good shape. And you can keep on drawing from whatever heaven has, and heaven will never tell you you have to wait until we get some more reserves. God is able. Not only is he economically able, he through his son is ethically qualified. Even Pilate checked him out, and Pilate says, I find no fault in him. And while he's on the cross, the Roman centurion said, surely this is the Son of God. And Nicodemus, who had a nighttime unscheduled appointment with him, said to him in John 3, Rabbi, we know your teacher come from God, because no one can do these miracles that you do except God be with him. So he is ethically qualified. And then he's legit. He really is. There were a whole lot of Jesuses, you know, during the time of Jesus. But he's the only one real Jesus. He fulfilled every messianic prophecy in the Old Testament. Every prophecy of the Messiah in the Psalms. In other words, everything that was said about him, he fulfilled it. He is not some kind of hoax. He is not some kind of fake. He really is the Son of God. And then he's able to pay the price. That's what Paul meant in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. You're not your own. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and your spirits, which are God. Let me tell you, salvation is not cheap. It cost Jesus something. It cost him his blood. And no one took his life. He laid it down a ransom for many. Well, they qualified. Tal and Teresa did. And as a result of qualifying, the papers were sent back to them to let them know that they were qualified to adopt a child. They set aside next thing. The child's not even born yet. They go into a room, and they say, this is going to be our daughter's room. They have named the girls, even before the girls are born. That's their room. That's their name, even before they're born. And when God takes and adopts you and adopts me, he has his son to go away to prepare a place for us. And if he prepares a place for us, he'll come again to receive us unto himself, John 14. And then he prays for us by name, because he knows our name. Well, when these young people, Tal and Teresa, got the word now that they should start preparing to come to China to get their girls, it still was going to take a few weeks, they started sending things to the girls. They sent T-shirts with her perfume on it and his deodorant on it, because they wanted the girls to smell what they were like. And they sent little small miniature picture albums, because they wanted the girls to kind of see someone who didn't have eyes that were slanted, wanted to see someone with rounded eyes. And when Jesus adopts us, he takes and sends us his word. You want to know what he's like? He sends us his word so that you can start getting familiar with him, because his word will speak to you. And then he sends us his spirit, because he comes and says, if I go, I will send my spirit who will live in you, because he is the spirit without skin who will get inside of your skin. And finally, the day came when it was time for them to go to China to get their daughters. When they went over there, the last thing that they had to do after signing the papers was to have their daughters to sign that they agreed to the adoption. Well, these girls at this particular time were less than a year old. How would they know how to sign anything? What they did was to take them into a room called the matching room, and they took the girls' feet and put their feet in some red ink on a pad, and then took their feet that had red ink on them, stamped it on the contract, so that in essence, these girls were saying, I agree to the adoption, even though they were not even old enough to write it down. Please don't accuse me of being a heretic. I just want to come close enough for you to think that I am. I've been saved 3 times. Wait a minute, don't write me off. First time I got saved was in eternity past, and I didn't know a thing about it. God thought of me. In fact, God, whatever you want to say about election, it's a doctrine, just don't mess it up. God elected me before I even was born, in eternity past, and I wasn't there. I got saved in history, because whatever God elected in eternity, he had to fulfill in history. And so in AD 30, Jesus Christ came to die for me, because it was no good just for me to be elected without a human demonstration. He had to die on the cross. He had to shed his blood. It had already been promised. He had to do that. And so the second time I got saved was when Jesus demonstrated in history my salvation. Third time I got saved is when I came down the aisle and I heard the gospel. In essence, what I was doing was taking my feet, having it stamped with red, not ink, but blood, and saying to God, I agree with what you did in eternity. I agree with what you did in history. And I want to say amen to it by saying, I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior. You know what? God wasn't even surprised. He wasn't shocked that I came down that aisle. He already knew that in eternity. He sent his son to take and die and confirm it in history. And now I came to validate what God had done in eternity and already had done in history. Some of you have come here right now. God wants you to come down that aisle, because he wants you to validate what he's already done in eternity and in history. This is the way Dwight Lyman Moody put it, when he talked about election, which he says, you don't talk about election unless you're talking about election in the family of God. He says, God voted for my salvation. The devil voted for my damnation. And I voted and broke the tie. Because when you come down that aisle, not that your vote has changed anything. It has confirmed what God has called. And God in 2 Timothy 3:9 is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And you've come here today to break the tie. You've come here today to say to God, you love me enough that you thought about me before I became myself. And you sent your son to die for me. And you come down that aisle and you're saying yes to God. I believe that your son not only died, but he rose again and is coming back again for me. Well, Israel, the covenant name of Jacob, crossed his hands. And he will cross his hands as he anticipates what God is going to do. He will cross his hands as he ponders, even without knowing the full progressive revelation of it, in anticipation of what God will do one more time. Because I think God is going to cross his hands once more when Jesus Christ will come again. And during the great glorious hope of the Lord will come and take us out of our orphanage. Because even though Paul says in Romans 8:15, God has not given us the spirit of slavery, which moves us back into fear, but has given us the spirit of adoption, whereby we can cry, Abba, Father. For his spirit, capital S, bears witness with our spirit, small s, that we are the sons of God. And if we are the children of God, then we are the heirs of God. And if we're the heirs of God, we are co-heirs with Christ Jesus. So that if we suffer with him, we should also be glorified with him. Well, we all adopted, those of us who know how to spell Father with a capital F. But verse 23 of Romans 8 says that we are waiting for our adoption. But Paul, you just got finished saying in verse 15 of Romans 8 that we are already adopted. Yes, Robert, but you didn't finish the rest of verse 23. We're waiting for our adoption, the redemption of our bodies. You see, we've been adopted spiritually, but we have not yet been adopted physically. We still get sick. There's still grief. There's still economic reverses. There's still relational rifts. And we're still in the orphanage down here. But one of these days, when Jesus will come again, he will come to take us out of our orphanage. He will come to deliver us out of this world that is often topsy-turvy. He will come to take us out of our mess. And when he comes, then we who are still in the orphanage, then he will come and take us to a home on high. Well, he is crossing his hands and he is reversing some bad things in our lives. Oh, yeah. And he is ordering our steps and he is orchestrating our movements and he is guiding our steps so that we meet up with his divine destination. And one of these days when we get out of this orphanage, one of these days when we're in his presence, we'll be able to sing anew, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I'm an heir of salvation. I've been purchased by God. I'm born of his spirit. I've been washed in his blood. This is my story and this is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Just keep on praising him. I know you're in the orphanage right now, but praise him because he's been so good. Praise him for salvation. Praise him for restoration. Praise him for justification. Praise him for redemption. Praise him for glorification. Praise him. Praise him. How do you spell Father? A lowercase F is not sufficient. If you can't spell Father with a capital F, you're dead in trespasses and sin. You're without God and you're without hope in the world. But today you can say, but God, when I was once afar off from him, has made me to draw nigh by the blood of the Lamb. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed, and everyone is standing at this time. Everyone is standing. God wants to do a work today. I know you have a biological father, but you need a spiritual father. He is the one who has paid the price for you. He sent his son to shed his blood just for you. He loved you that much. I just believe that if you were the only person that was ever born, Jesus would have come to die for you. Loves you. He's able to sustain you every moment of your life. He's one who is qualified to do it. He's blameless, he's sinless, he's spotless. And he's one who has come to be exactly like you. In fact, he who knew no sin became sin, that you and I who are sinners may be made the righteousness of God. And yes, Hebrews 7:25 reminds us that he has won this Christ, who is our high priest, whoever liveth to make intercession for you. You wonder why you didn't die in that accident? You wonder why you didn't escape a possible catastrophe? You wonder why when you were in the wrong place doing the wrong thing that you escaped some fatality? It's because God is not slack concerning his promise, but is long-suffering, wanted this moment to come for you to be able to walk down the aisle and break the tie, so to speak. I invite you right now, knowing this great God that we serve, this great God who loved us even to the end, death of his son on the cross. He wants you today to come from the orphanage of sin to live in the family of God. I don't care what your sin is. I don't care how bad you are. I don't care where you've been. You are redeemable. You can be bought back today. And he can make it as if you've never sinned before. No condemnation, no separation. You are in Christ today. I invite you to come. In the balcony, I invite you to come. Don't wait on anyone else. Don't procrastinate. Don't put it off. You sense the Spirit speaking to you right now. Come on now. Come on. Come on. Wherever you are. You've heard the gospel before, but you never really responded to it explicitly to the point where you take your feet, have it stamped with red, not ink, but the blood of Jesus. I invite you to come. Come now, wherever you are. Come on now. Come now, wherever you are. Don't wait on anybody else.